Alrighty everyone, it's the moment that we've all been waiting for. It's time to give Tron Legacy a sequel. But, you know, not an actual sequel, of course. One of the fake sequels, which includes me talking for 10 to 20 minutes instead of an actual movie. Anyways, today I'll be recapping what I love about Tron Legacy, what could be better about the Tron world, and how that translates into the story and world building of the third film. Now, ever since Tron Legacy came out in 2010, I've defended it as a beautiful film. I mean, I absolutely love it. And recently, my love for the film has grown even further into the snooty video essay side of things. But don't worry, my video essays won't be snooty, because I like to use the interesting phrase,
in my opinion.
I mean, my videos are hardly video essays anyway, so whatever. Anyways, Tron Legacy is an amazing film. Yes, we know, and is probably one of the many films that have continued to inspire me to create my own stories since it came out in 2010. So let's jump back into the digital frontier as we look at the unknowable future of Tron. Greetings, programs! And it's time for a speed round I like to call Everything Amazing About Tron Legacy in Less Than a Minute! Here we go! A man learning that the most important thing to him isn't his work or perfecting the world, but his family. A kid growing up and learning that when the world deals you a bad hand, you can do something about it rather than start
chilling in Costa Rica.
A girl learning that she's a dog?
I guess you could say I'm a rescue.
Amazing world building featuring an aesthetically pleasing world that rolled a nat 20 on architecture. Awesome fucking bikes. Disc battles, de-rezzing, continuity with the preceding film. Groundbreaking stellar visual effects. Talking about the sun, knocking on the sky.
Biodigital jazz, man.
Teamwork, learning from your past mistakes, and learning that perfection is not a reasonable goal. Those are the things that I love about Tron Legacy. If I didn't mention what you love about the movie, please let me know down in the comments. I would love to see what other people love about this film. All right, now that we have that out of the way, I want to ask a question that I've had some difficulty doing for a movie that I love so much. What can we do to improve this world so we can set it up for a potential sequel? Tron Legacy already does a great job of setting up for a sequel on its own, but I want to go over two main points that really grind my gears, and then we'll jump into the sequel. Point number one, more interesting bad guys, please. Now in the world of Tron, the difference between good and evil are very clear. The bad guys are red, pretty simple. But beyond that, the red lighting indicates that a program is serving the Master Control Program, or MPC. Whether it be in the original Tron film or even Tron Legacy, where Clue acts as the MPC. But the one thing that I find really disinteresting about this is that in most cases, not all cases, but most cases, bad guys aren't bad because they choose to follow the MPC, but because they were taken and repurposed. They were simply just given new programming to follow the Master Control Program. Which does make sense, we are talking about computer programs here. But for a story, it just isn't very interesting to me. So what I'm getting at is that there really isn't any arguing for the dark side in this franchise, because there are barely any actual people, or programs I guess, serving the dark side at will. There was no choice, and in the cases when people do get a choice, they usually choose to fight on the light side. This can also be supported by the fact that Kevin Flynn and the users in general are pretty much looked at as gods. In the original Tron film, when a program refers to his user, the guards respond with saying,
"Great, another religious nut."
Also in Tron Legacy, when Flynn enters the battle at the end of Line Club,
"Everything changed."
And a woman can be seen praying on her knees as he departs. Users being gods is also supported by the fact that users can alter things around them when they are on the grid. This user/god situation makes sense in terms of the fact that humans literally control computers in real life, but it doesn't really do much narratively, at least in my opinion. All of this doesn't really define red as bad per se, and every other color as good per se, but it defines red as almost enslaved or brainwashed, while every other color means the program is free to do their own thinking, or, you know, they're a user. This relationship is pretty interesting, but was never truly explored in the films. But if the story of Tron Legacy were to have explored the dynamic of seeing the red programs as slaves, I don't think it could have had much to say. The simple solution in this world is that once Sam leaves the grid and returns to the material world, he just needs to delete slavery from the computer. And not only could that come off as a rather arrogant solution to the problem, but it isn't very compelling. So how do you make it compelling? Well, in my opinion, there's one simple solution. The programs can choose to join the dark side. I know, crazy, right? And yes, there already are small cases of programs choosing to join the dark side on their own, but let's say that in this case, it would be more of a common political stance for a program to take, rather than just a case-by-case basis being more isolated. But don't worry, we'll come back to this. All of this will play smoothly into our rough idea for Tron 3. Point 2. The ISOs.
What was it?
I've cracked it, he kept saying.
The one who vanquished the tyranny of the user!
He was talking about genetic algorithms, quantum teleportation.
Just when I thought it couldn't get any more profound. Something unexpected had happened.
He said he was about to change everything. Science, medicine, religion.
The miracle.
A miracle.
The black and white view of good and evil comes to a halt here. Sure, the MPC can be labeled as a representation of evil, but when it comes to the ISOs, all certainty is lost. Throughout the film, Kevin Flynn refers to the ISOs as what would have been his big break.
The possibilities of their root code, their digital DNA, disease, history, science, philosophy, every idea man has ever had about the universe up for grabs.
Biodigital jazz, man.
The ISOs. That were gonna be my gift to the world.
Well, more than just his big break, but a break for the whole world. Now let's take a step back and look at what ISO means. It stands for isomorphic algorithm, and the term isomorphic is defined as corresponding or similar in form and relations. So what do ISOs correspond to? What is similar in form to the ISOs? My first thought was, well, programs. They're life forms that reside in the grid, so they correspond to programs. But programs have something that no ISO or human have, which is a directly defined purpose. Programs are created with a goal that they must complete. In the original Tron film, many programs talk to each other about what their purposes are and why their users created them. On the new grid featured in Tron Legacy and Tron Uprising, these purposes are found in what us humans would see as a program's job. The difference between it being their purpose and it just being a job is that it isn't really up to them, but since they were designed to complete these tasks, they're happy with it. You don't see Microsoft Word complaining about its existence, like Rick's butter passer.
What is my purpose?
You pass butter.
Oh my god.
Humans, on the other hand, aren't created with a single, very clear purpose. We go our whole lives trying to figure out why we were created and what our job is here, and we may never find the true answer, compared to programs who wake up knowing exactly what they gotta do. Now, this is a trait that the ISOs also share, a trait that eventually got them killed.
For centuries, we've dreamed of gods, spirits, aliens, an intelligence beyond our own. You seeing this? I found them in here.
Although the ISOs are a creation of technology, which technology was made by man, they really are a manifestation of the unknown, a representation of the universe, demonstrating that perfection just isn't possible. Now, whether or not ISOs are superior to humans is a different story, but in my opinion, it's safe to assume that they might be, given that Kevin Flynn saw them as the solution to the world's problems. The uncalled manifestation of the ISOs can be seen as a prime example of the scariest potential of artificial intelligence. In the real world, the automation of jobs is probably the biggest problem people have to face in the 21st century. Having robots do the menial work so we don't have to really is an ideal scenario. We don't have to do the work, and businesses don't have to pay minimum wage to robots. And us humans are left to just pursue whatever we want, whatever fulfills us, and we don't have to feel undermined or underpaid or underappreciated at whatever job we might be working. Programs, being the robots in this situation, are created with individual purpose that can be fulfilled. But what if one day programs began to develop themselves and are found to have similarly unfound purpose in life? If the ISOs were to become real in our world, we would begin to debate the interesting topic of robot rights. At the end of Tron Legacy, life on the grid is seemingly destroyed after the destruction of Clue and Flint. Sam and Korra make it out alive, saving what I can only assume is the grid to a small drive that Sam wears as a necklace. So where does this bring us in terms of Tron 3, or Tron Ascension, or whatever you want to call it? Well, here's my idea. By the time that Sam or Korra or whoever decides to return to the grid, they're met with a surprise. The grid is teeming with life, despite the fact that it was left empty. The ISOs have manifested once again, creating their new world. And the users come waltzing back into their world. At first, they can be welcomed, sure. As to the ISOs, the humans are basically their first contact with an outside species. But to the rest of the human world, the ISOs are still just computer programs. So this puts Sam and Korra or whoever in a difficult place, as they're the only people who truly understand both sides. This gives us a little bit of what we talked about earlier. A more interesting view on good and evil. Every program now has to decide their opinion of whether or not the users should be welcome or not. The users could enslave them. They could destroy their world, everything that they've built. Or on the other side, the users could bring two worlds together in the best way possible, a dream Kevin Flynn once had that Tron would continue to preach in this new world. Now, I don't know if you were expecting a fully written out script or more than that when it comes to a sequel, but this base idea is all I need. To me, this idea is much more compelling than an NPC taking over the grid. Not drawing a clear line between good and evil is essential to me, while simultaneously bringing in many issues that surround us today, such as class division between programs, as well as the threat of artificial intelligence on the human world. This to me is what Tron's true potential is. It's in the perfect position to be a super cool story while also serving as a commentary for real-world issues. And while the franchise is currently viewed as a visual and audible marvel, it lacks one thing that stops it from becoming what it deserves, and that is a complicated, rich, and fluent story. Now, don't get me wrong, I love the story of Tron Legacy as it is. If I didn't, this video would be titled, "What if Tron Legacy were actually good?" But instead, I decided to focus on the sequel because I don't want to impose my own ideas on a movie that inspired me in the first place. But that's just my idea. And obviously, Disney is in no place to give Tron any more attention. Every time they talk about the Tron ride or they released that Lego set a few years ago, it gives me small hope that Disney is testing the market to see if they could do more Tron. But, you know, why risk your money on something new and original when they know that making sequel after sequel works? And Disney can obviously do whatever they want, but in my opinion, it's their job as a studio to take risks on new stories instead of settling for what's safe. But that's a topic for a different video. I'll see you all next time on Kunin's Cove.